deliver me. A reading from Isaiah chapter 52. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them they see, and that which they have not heard they understand. But thou, O Lord, have mercy on us. A reading from Hebrews chapter 2. For it was not to angels that God subjected the world to come, of which we are speaking. It has been testified somewhere, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower, for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, putting everything in subjection under his feet. Now in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him. But we see him who, for a little while, was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. But thou, O Lord, have mercy on us. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 28th chapter. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. But thou, O Lord, have mercy on us.
Praise be to thee, O Lord."
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We see millions of citizens fleeing from their war-torn country. We watch tens of millions of babies being murdered by abortion since Roe v. Wade passed in the 1970s. We experience families torn apart by addiction, and we hear the devastating news that a loved one has incurable cancer. This is what we see in the world. We turn on the news only to be confronted yet again by the evil that is in the world. We see the effect that sin has on the world, and quite honestly, we can be left confused when we come to our readings for tonight. We just heard in our epistle reading, now in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. And then we heard in our gospel reading, and Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." Now for these past few weeks, we have heard about Jesus as the prophet and the priest. But now how are we to understand him for tonight as king in the kingdom of grace? Yes, we do see him as the prophet and the priest, as they have talked about previously. But how is he the king in the kingdom of grace? But before we can unpack his role as the king in this kingdom, we first have to discuss what this kingdom is all about. Over the next 2 weeks, we're going to be talking about two different kingdoms, the kingdom of grace and the kingdom of glory. Next week, we'll learn about the kingdom of glory, but for this week, we're focusing on the kingdom of grace. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, we are in the kingdom of grace right now. It is the church here on earth of which we are a part of. In our baptism, by the means of grace, we are made members of this kingdom. Jesus is the king of this kingdom, and we read in our epistle that everything is in subjection to him. Now, while it is certainly true that everything is under his control, how are we supposed to understand his role as king in the kingdom when we see the world around us? After all, wouldn't we expect everything to just be smooth sailing? Wouldn't we want him to rule with a mighty arm and take away all of our troubles? Wouldn't we want him to be wearing this type of crown? We aren't the only ones expecting this type of king. The Jews during the time of Jesus were expecting a Messiah who would make your enemies a footstool for your feet, as Psalm 110 says. They expected a Messiah to come and rule as a king on earth in the likeness of David, one who would wear that earthly crown. But what did they see instead? While they did see the Messiah come, the Son of God taking on human flesh, the Messiah was not born to rule in an earthly palace like they expected. Instead, he was born in a manger in a no-name town. He did not triumphantly ride into Jerusalem on some white horse and defeat all the Romans. No, he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey in order to be crucified. He did not receive a jeweled crown. Instead, he received a crown of thorns. This was their long-expected Messiah. And many didn't recognize him. They expected a Messiah who would exercise his power here on earth, but Christ didn't come and exercise the power here in the way that they wanted. Instead, our epistle reads, "But we see him who, for a little while, was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus. He took on human flesh, took our sins upon himself, and suffered the price for our sins. As the prophet Isaiah foretold, he wrote, 'His appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind.' He was beaten, mocked, and nailed to the cross. He died and he rose on the third day." Luther writes in the explanation of the second article of the Apostles' Creed that Jesus purchased and won me from all sins, from death, and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood and with his innocent suffering and death, that I may be his own and live under him in his kingdom. He tasted death for everyone by his crucifixion and then his resurrection, in order that all who believed would have eternal life in the kingdom of glory, which is to come. So when these bad things do happen, which we know all too well that they do happen, it can sometimes be hard to understand our epistle for tonight and to remember that he is in fact the king of this kingdom of grace. Now, I'm not going to be diving into why bad things still happen. That can be saved for another sermon or a Bible class. But it would appear that we aren't alone in struggling with understanding Jesus' kingship. The author author of Hebrews seems to have anticipated such struggling, and so he writes, "At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him." That little phrase, "at present," is speaking of our life here on earth, meaning that in this life, we do not always see how it's possible that God is in control. But yet, we are reminded time and time again that everything is in subjection to him. We do not always see why these things happen, but we do see our Savior, Jesus, the King of the Kingdom of Grace. As King, he still guards and protects his kingdom here on earth. Paul writes in 2 Thessalonians 3, "But the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one." And so it's in response to this that here in a few minutes we will sing these words: "Preserve in wave and tempest thy storm-tossed little flock. Assailed by wind and weather, may it endure each shock. Take thou the helm, O pilot, and set the course aright. Thus we shall reach the harbor in thine eternal light." Christ reigns victorious over the kingdom here on earth, and we eagerly await the day where he will come again and where we will live with him in his kingdom of glory forever and ever. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. The ushers may now come forward and receive the offering.
lion's mouth, O Lord. Christ became obedient unto death,
even the death of the cross.
Christ was wounded for our transgressions.
He was bruised for our iniquities.
O Lord, have mercy upon us. O Christ,
have mercy upon us.
O Lord,
have mercy upon us.
O Christ,
hear thou us.
O God, the Father in heaven,
have mercy upon us.
O God, the Son, Redeemer of the world,
have mercy upon us.
O God, the Holy Ghost, be gracious unto us.
Spare us, good Lord.
Be gracious unto us.
Help us, good Lord.
From all sin, from all error, from all evil.
Good Lord, deliver us.
From the crafts and assaults of the devil, from sudden and evil death, from pestilence and famine, from war and bloodshed, from sedition and rebellion, from lightning and tempest, from all calamity by fire and water, and from everlasting death.
Good Lord, deliver us.
By the mystery of thy holy incarnation, by thy holy nativity, by thy baptism, fasting, and temptation, by thine agony and bloody sweat, by thy cross and passion, by thy precious death and burial, by thy glorious resurrection and ascension, and by the coming of the Holy Ghost, the Comforter.
Help us, good Lord.
In all time of our tribulation, in all time of our prosperity, in the hour of death, and in the day of judgment,
help us, good Lord.
poor sinners do beseech thee, and to rule and govern thy holy Christian church, to preserve all pastors and ministers of thy church in the true knowledge and understanding of thy word and in holiness of life, to put an end to all schisms and causes of offense, to bring into the way of truth all such as have erred and are deceived, to beat down Satan under our feet, to send faithful laborers into thy harvest, to accompany thy word with thy spirit and grace, to raise up them that fall, and to strengthen such as do stand, and to comfort and help the weak-hearted and the distressed.
We beseech thee to hear us, Lord.
To give to all nations peace and concord, to preserve our country from discord and contention, to give to our nation perpetual victory over all its enemies, to direct and defend our president and all in authority, and to bless and keep our magistrates and all our people.
We beseech thee to hear us, Lord.
To behold and help all who are in danger, necessity, and tribulation, to protect all who travel by land or water, to preserve all women in the perils of childbirth, to strengthen and keep all sick persons and young children, to set free all who are innocently imprisoned, to defend and provide for all fatherless children and widows, and to have mercy upon all men.
We beseech thee to hear us, Lord.
To forgive our enemies, persecutors, and slanderers, and to turn their hearts. To give and preserve to our use the fruits of the earth, and graciously to hear our prayers.
We beseech thee to hear us, Lord.
O Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world,
have mercy upon us.
O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world,
have mercy upon us.
O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world,
grant us thy peace.
O Christ,
hear thou us.
O Lord,
have mercy upon us.
O Christ,
have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Amen. Our Father,
see upon us, Christ, have mercy upon us, Lord, have mercy upon us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
O God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that we, being defended by thee from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness. Through the merits of Jesus Christ our Savior, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
Bless we the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all.
Amen.